Beginning current daven, Sefta Shabbos Deb Tzadi Hei. Begin on the bottom of Tzadi Tamad Beis. Full lines up at the bottom of the Yemen. We will continue to explain the halacha of our previous Mishnah regarding different Tzadis, derivatives of some Av Malachas. Our Shir's co-sponsor becomes a Pinchesco Torah anytime, Deb Achayim, everyone who's joining us, greatly appreciate it. So we're going to discuss in today's daven Machlekes between Rebavon and Rebavon, which Malachas are violated when a woman braids her hair or paints her eyes. Interestingly, what is that, like, those cosmetics, the self-care, what Malachas are being done? In addition, we have a brice that's going to have another similar machlek. It's regarding making cheese, milking your cows, training milk, which malachas there are tailada of. Some important terms and concepts are going to come as Reb Shimon is going to say, put to bezel, bezel, regarding halacha, regarding otzitz, regarding a flower pot, either if there's no hole, which is what's called ena nokov, or nokov, if there is a hole, he holds either way, one is potter from picking it up. It's not considered a malacha of toilish. Terminology in a sarcastic way is katal kana ba'agma, like as if your rebbe cuts reeds in the swamp, like as if he doesn't know how to interpret a mishnah. Otzis nakev, like we said, is the halacha of a flower pot that has a hole in the bottom, which runs into the halachic discussion if it's considered attached to the ground because it nourishes from the ground because there's a hole. Hechshas ram is the halacha that food items can only become susceptible to tumah when they're in contact with one of the seven liquids called Yad Shachadam, which is an acronym to remember one of the seven liquids that can make it susceptible to tumah. If it's not, didn't touch the liquids, yet it's not susceptible to tumah. And also the halacha of mukav tamid pasul, which is that although kli cheres could be mekabel tumah in the oil ames, but if the contents are surrounded with a tightly fastened seal, that protects the contents of what's inside. So we begin the current daf tzadi daven beis following zavad ramen yamin, where our mishnah said the chenai gridelas the hulu. There was three different items. There was a machlekes Rabbi Eliezer and the Chacham in our Mishnah, if it's a chiv deraisa or it's a chiv derabana, which gedeles is regarding when she braids her hair, kecheles is when she paints her eye, and pekeses actually is two interpretations of Rashi. Either it's a certain type of combing of the hair, or it's a woman who puts dough on her face to redden it, and when she removes the dough, that causes something for her complexion. Those are three different activities that the Rabbi Eliezer hold, you're actually this is the rice there. I'm coming to say it's all rabbinically forbidden. So that's what the Gemara discusses. Gedeles, this regarding if the woman goes and breeds her here, kecheles, and the pekeses, according to Rabbi Eliezer, what is going to be the liability? What chiv the rice are you doing when you're doing these three acts? So Amar Abba and Amar Abizu Rabbi Chanin, this is gedeles, interestingly. So when the woman breeds her hair, it's mishum a reges, it's weaving. That's what she does with her hair. She's like weaving the strands of her hair. Kecheles, when she paints her eyes, is mishum kesevis, is because of writing. Because what she does with the applicator, she goes around the eye like a person that takes the quill around the letter. So she's tracing around her eye like one does when they're tracing a letter. And pekeses, which again, someone pointed out after last year, a place is elsewhere, but Taisa also says similarly that although Rashi says, let's say it's coming with the ear, Taisa says, no, that's not going to be what the Gemara is saying right now, Mishum Taibu, because of spinning. Taisa rejects the interpretations, and elsewhere he says it doesn't know what Pekeses is, but Rashi holds, it's like this halacha of combing the hair. He says what it is when you're putting your finger, when you're fixing your hair with your fingers, so you're straightening out what gets entangled. So he holds that's somewhat related to that of spinning of a thread, or according to the other interpretations, putting the dough on the face. So what they would do is they would make the strand, they would make from the dough, they would make these threads, like almost like a thread out of the dough. So that's like spinning. What's spinning? Spinning is you take the wool and you make a thread out of it. So the dough is also that you make these threads out of it, I guess, somehow when they would put it on their face. So again, those are two difficult interpretations, but that's how Rashi says that would be the violation of spinning when your pekes is, again, easier when you're straightening out your hair, you're making each strand individually, disentangling, so it's making it into like a thread. That's what spinning is. Or regarding that of like the dough, that it would make it into like a thread. But on either way, on that, the Gemara rejects that interpretation. They said in front of Rebbe Vo, how's it possible that these are the violations? What, you think that's the way of weaving? When you're braiding the hair, that's the normal way of weaving? Is that the way you write? Is that the way you spin a thread? In other words, the halachic violation of a biblical malacha has to be the normal way. That's not usually what you do when you braid. When you braid, it's not, that's not the way that you weave. And that's not the way how you write. And that's not the way how you spin. So Elam Ravoh, he gives a different interpretation. He says, I heard that, as you continue on Tzadi Hem and Aleph, kecheles, the problem with painting, meaning painting the eye, it's like makeup, is mishum tzevas, because cause of dying. It's coloring the person's person's skin. Gedeles, braiding the hair. Pekeses, which is like the interpretation of fixing the hair or the complexion, is mishum b'inah, because of building. It says the Gemara, chider b'inah b'keh. Well, that's the way of building. Why is that any different than the first interpretation? It says the Gemara, and yes, why is that considered building? Interesting, Agadic Gemara, the even Hashem Elikinas Atzela, it says that God built the side, meaning he took Atzela, which is a different interpretation of what it means from Adam when he was sleeping, took the side of him, and he went and he built it. But it wasn't he built it. So Malama comes to teach, especially according to the interpretation, holds that Adam and Chava were androgynous, they were two halves of one half was male, one half was female, so it doesn't mean you have to build her. You don't have to build her, she's really one side of her. So Malama comes to teach, what he did was, he braided her here. And he brought her in a beautified state to admiration. She came to Krachayim, like we find in the maritime cities. Currently, Kliyasa, they're called the braider benisa, the builder. It means to say that is a form of building the person by braiding the hair, and therefore that's considered a derech of binyan bekach. Like we find that it's called a Kaddish Baruch went and built Chava by braiding the hair, and therefore that's the interpretation of these three malachas, while according to Rabbi Yezu, they're going to be malachas deraisa, from dying, and the other two of building. And Shimon says, this halacha, gedeles of braiding the hair, kecheles of painting the eye, or pekeses and combing the hair, la'atma, if she's doing it for herself, Petrush is going to be exempt, because you can't really do it so well, and it's not the normal way to do it if you're doing it on your own. It's very hard to do it as well, I guess if you're not looking in the mirror or something like that, it's very hard to get it so perfect. But l'chaverta, it's only if a woman's doing it for her friend, where then she could see and she could do it well, then chayeves, then she's going to be liable. That's going to be the way to do it in the most bona fide way, to be a malacha d'araisa. B'chein, also, as Rashi explains, what's the b'chein, there's a different halacha regarding Shabbos, regarding a related type of prohibition. It's just that it was also hayyur b'shim min alazo aim, b'shim alazo said, this time in the name of b'shim aliyazer, says, isha le tabis rak, a person should not put some type of a makeup, which is some type of red dye, which is called rouge, al panel on our face, nisha tevas, because it's dying. It's a problem of putting on this red makeup, because it's dying her skin. Again, similar to like what we said before, when you put on this stuff on the face, it makes it into a type of malacha tzaveh. Now, a similar type of machlekes, Rabbi Eliezer and Rabban, and again, regarding different activities, that are also mundane activities like putting on makeup and combing hair, and here it's regarding that related to milk, if it's a malacha d'araisa or malacha d'Rabban. So, Rabban, hachaylev, if someone milks a cow, or the hamachabetz, or if someone goes in two interpretations in Rashi, either it's that he's curdling the milk in the keva, which is the stomach of the cow, that's how they make it into cheese, but that's the first stage, or Rashi says actually the second stage. After you curdled it, you take like a gemi kli, and you put that kum inside of it, which is that milk that you got, and it separates the what's called the mehachal of the water of the milk, which is the whey, the drips out, and you're left with those clumps, that's mechabitz. Again, it's either the first stage of curdling, or it's the second stage of straining the milk. And hamagabin, and of making cheese, which that's a later stage, that's when you actually clump it together. So these three malachas, again, of milking an animal, straining the milk, and making cheese, their shear, what's the minimum shear of being violating that malacha? We didn't say exactly what malacha it is yet. What's the minimum? It's kagregis, the size of a dried fig. Like we said, regarding food items, the shear is always, no matter what the malacha is, it's a shear of a kagregis. Then we say, hamachabit, if someone is sweeping a house, or bahamarabit, or if someone is settling the dust, where in Talmudic times they had dust floors, not so long ago they had dust floors, they would settle it with water so that the dust shouldn't rise. Of haredechal is dvash. If someone goes and takes down a honeycomb from where it's on the ground, so regarding these three things, Rebbe Machlekes, and regarding the previous three things also, shogeg b'Shabbos, it was done by mistake on Shabbos, so chayev chatas, which Gemara later on is going to explain what's the violation of taking honeycombs, taking the honeycomb down. It's because of toilish. You see, toilish is not attached to the ground, and mechaber merabit is sweeping and of settling the dust is because of boinet, because of building. But that's if you do it by mistake, so you have a chattis. Here's the b'yantiv, you do it deliberately on yantiv. Like our bum, you're going to get 40 lashes. I mean, it's even on yantiv. That's divrei Rabbi Eliezer. So again, Rabbi Eliezer, like in our Mishnah, says these mundane activities are biblical malachas. But the sages say, like in our Mishnah, say, no, echad zeh ve'echad zeh. Whether it's Shabbos, whether it's yantiv, It's only going to be a rabbinic violation because maybe you're going to gather together the dust when you're sweeping and you're going to fill up the holes in the house by itself, and that's going to be binyan. But that's again only rabbinic concern that that might happen. But just sweeping and just settling the dust is not a malacha d'oraisa, and therefore it's only going to be a rabbinic violation. Now, the Gemara brings a story related to this first half of the halachas. If Nachma Gurya Ikla Narda, they asked for him, Chaylev, comes a visiting sage, the scholar in residence. They said, Chaylev, when you milk an animal, what's the problem? The rabbis told us you can't milk a cow, what's the liability? Somebody said, then Mishum Chaylev, because of Chaylev. So then they asked him, Mechabitz Mishum Mechayev, when you're straining the milk, the first stage of making the cheese, what's the liability? Mishum Mechabitz, because of Mechabitz. So then they asked him, Megabin Mishum Mechayev, when you're making the cheese, putting the clumps together, what are you liable for? Because I'm making cheese. So Amr Le, they said to him, Rabuch, is your teacher Kotl Kani Ba'ag Mahavah? He would go ahead and cut reeds in the swamps. And say, he does not explain the Mishnah. We asked him this thing. Why can't you do this? Oh, because you can't do this. That's what I'm asking you. Actually, someone just told me yesterday, he was asking me, he said, when he goes to his Rav and he asks him, but why? He said, because Azoy State. They said, but why? Azoy State. He says, what do you mean? But why? And that was, they go in cycles. He said, but you're telling me the same thing as what I'm asking you. So Asa Shal ben Midrasha. So he came to the Beis HaMedrash and he asked. So Amalei, they told him the reason. Chaylev, the problem with milking is Chay Mishim Mefarik. It's because of, like when you're saying, like an animal that you have to unload the load. Mefarik is to unload the load. What does it mean, Mefarik? Mefarik is that you unload a food item from where it was originally gathered, which is the derivative of the malacha of dush, of threshing. Just like threshing, when you have the stalks and the animals, or the machine goes over and it steps in it, it pulls out the kernel from the stalk. That's exactly what happens when you're milking an animal. You're taking out the milk from the udder. You're moving the liquid from where it's originally stored. That's the malacha of chaylev of milking. Mechabitz, what's the violation of straining the milk? Chay mishum butter. It's a problem because of selecting. When you're taking out the food item, which is the clumps, from the psilis, which is the whey, which is the watery part of the milk. And since it's, although it's generally allowed to do eichel from psilis, but since it's done through a vessel and it's for a later point in time, that's a violation of mechabitz, of straining the milk. And megaba, what's the problem about making cheese? Is chai mishum baina, because you're building, you're putting together clumps, making a structure of the cheese. So that's the first half of the halacha. Then the Gemara explains, we said in the second half of the braisa was hamachabit, if someone sweeps, hamarabit, if he's settling the dust, or if he takes, he removes the honeycombs. So that's what we said in machlekes. Shagri, which obviously we do by mistake on Shabbos, yichayim achatas. He says, b'yamtiv, be deliberately in yamtiv. So when you do malacha d'araisa deliberately, like a bomb, so then on yamtiv you get 40 lashes, that's the Rabbi Eliezer. Now, on that, on Rabbi Eliezer, he says, my time is Rabbi Eliezer. What's the reason, Rabbi Eliezer, that he says that chalas davash, removing the honeycombs, is going to be issa d'iraisa, that you're going to be chay b'chatas? But what's the malacha? So that's a more interesting source. So there's a pasuk in Shmuel Aleph that talks about when Yehoinasan didn't know about the gzeir that his father Shaul had made, that no one's supposed to eat. It says in the pasuk, v'yitbol isa, that he went and he like the pasuk says, but he didn't hear when his father made the oath of the people, and he sent the edge of his stick, which was just in his hand, and it says, v'yatbol isa, and he dipped his stick, v'yaris ha-devash. So we all know this word because there's a famous sefer called yaris devash. But what does yaris devash mean? It means the forest of the honey. So it says the Gemara, v'chimayin yaris ha-devash. What does a forest have to do with honey? What do you mean the forest of the honey? So lemel chaviyadim, what's the pasuk coming to tell you? A drush. Maya, just like a forest, ha-toilish menim b'shabbos. If someone detaches something from the forest on Shabbos, he's michayim b'chatas because of toilish. Afchalas devash. So too, interesting, zayit sakasim. So if someone goes and takes a honeycomb, her regimen on Shabbos, and someone takes down from it on Shabbos, it's mechayev chatas, milav chatas, because of Taylish. Because it's considered, and Taylish also explains exactly what does this mean, but that's on the simple understanding, the pasuk is comparing it to the forest. And just like over there, it's going to be a malacha, so over here, somehow we consider it as also something that's attached, and therefore by removing it, it's going to be considered detaching. Now, the Gemara says, although we said that you're not allowed to be merabits, which is to settle the dust, but there are a few important exemptions for this violation. A Mamer, it says, Shara Zilcha, he permitted sprinkling, meaning which is essentially the malacha of merabits, of settling the dust in the house, b'mechuz in the town of mechuzah. Why? Because Mechuzah, they had stone floors. It was a very wealthy, affluent town. And therefore, they didn't have dust floors. So Amar, he said, time of Amar Rabban, why did the rabbi say that it's forbidden to do this? Is Dilma Asla Shri Gumaris, again, according to Rabbanan, that they hold it's only rabbinically forbidden. Is it because you might come to fill up the holes when you're settling the dust? There's no holes over here. Our floors are made out of, they're tiled floors. And because of that, that's therefore there's no problem about settling the dust. And this is a discussion that we're showing them places here, if the same thing is regarding also sweeping, because there's no problem about sweeping anymore. Again, there might be other problems about muktzah, but there's no problem about filling up the holes because our floors are tiled and they don't have the problem about building the house by filling up the holes. Another exemption the Gemara brings is Rabbi Teisvash Kechil de Ravina. He encountered Ravina. He was in pain that he had from the ear, which dust was rising and is causing a lot of difficult ear to breathe, like people have with these allergies. They have to the allergen to dust. So it was, there's so much dust in the room. So, and some say, but Amrila, that the story was Marka Shisha Bereidu Rav Ashkel Ravashi, he encountered Ravashi, to Komet Sar Mahav, the same story, just a question of who's the Amayur, that he saw that he was in pain from the ear. So Amalei says, Leisovel Amar Lohad Tanya, doesn't the master hold, we learn the Braisa? Says, Aroitz L'Rabbit says, Beis B'Shabbos, someone wants to sell the dust in the Sasan Shabbos. And the reason is because it's only a rabbinic decree, according to Rabbanan, not like Rabbi Eliezer. And because of that, because of a pain to a person, they found a certain loophole, halachic loophole, what to do. Maybe our neva malei mayim. Bring a trough full with water. V'reichetz panam b'zavazu. Now you let her wash your face in this corner, and then yadav b'zavazu in your hands in another corner. V'ragla b'zavazu in your feet in another corner. And then zavais mitzrayus meila. It comes out incidentally that the house has been settled with water because all you're doing is washing your hands, which you're allowed to do, and you're not doing it directly to settle the house, and that will just settle the dust. So malei said to him, labataytai. He says, I wasn't mindful of this either. It means say I didn't recall. You're right. I forgot about that hetter. Or Rashi's different interpretation is that I don't hold it, I have to. So, be that as it may, that's why he didn't do it. But Tanu within the bright said that, yeah, Isha Chacham, a smart woman, which either means to say that she's a wife of a Talmud Chacham, or she's the daughter of a Talmud Chacham, that she heard this from her father. Marbet says, basically, for Shabbos, she would sell the dust of her house on Shabbos because she would wash the pots in this corner, the cups in this corner, and again, before she's done, the whole house has, the dust has been settled. Now, the Gemara concludes, actually, we don't need these heterim. Because Ve'idna now, today, the Sri Lanka Rebbe Shimon that we rule, like Rebbe Shimon, that he holds Davish and Meskabin, something that's unintended is going to be permitted. Now, if someone is settling the dust, his intention is not to have the earth stick to the holes and to smooth out the floor of the house to make it into Baina. He just doesn't want the earth to rise. Sure, if a Ketchila, then it's permitted even the Ketchila because it's not a Psikrasia. It's Davish and Meskabin, you're not intending to do this thing. And therefore, it's anyway permitted, so you don't need the Satan. You're allowed to go ahead and settle the dust, and we're not concerned that it possibly. That this might happen, that it might fill up the holes. Then I look at the next Mishnah, continuing on a different malacha, this time the malacha of kaitzer, of reaping, which is cutting the stalks from where they grow. So the Mishnah says the following halacha, a toilish ma'atzis nakar, this is a toilada of kaitzer, which is toilish, which is tearing, pulling something off from where it grows. So if someone plucks from a atzis nakar, an atzis nakar is a flower pot, that has a hole. So Chayiv is going to be liable. Why is he liable if he's picking up that flower pot? Because it's considered attached to the ground. Why? Because since there's a hole, so it nourishes from the ground, through the hole, because it smells the moisture of the ground, and even if the hole, Rashi learns, is on the side of the pot, it's also going to be Chayiv if you lift it up, because it's nourishing from the ground, it's getting it through the hole. Now, but let's say there's no hole at all. Oh, there's no hole, so then pot it, then you give me exempt because who cares on the ground? It's not nourishing, it's considered a detached thing. That's the Chacham. But Reb Shimon paitib is Abizem. Shimon says, now either one are going to be potter, we're going to consider both of them as detached. It's not attached because of the hole. That's what the Gemara asked in Reb Shimon's opinion. Rami le Abai le Rav, Abai asked the Rav, Ramallah, some say it was Rav Chia Barav le Rav. Whoa, wait a second. It's not, we looked in the Mishnah, Reb Shimon paitib is Abizem. He says it doesn't make a difference, not like the Tanakhama, it doesn't make it a hole or not a hole. So, what meaning that either one you're going to be putter for lifting it up on Shabbos. So, Amu, you see, the knock of Reb Shimon, when there is a hole, according to Reb Shimon, because in the knock of Mashmah, he says it's considered the same thing as when there's no hole at all, which is always going to be considered detached. Remember, but there seems to be a contradiction from the following verse. Shimon, I mean, he says, Ain bein knock of Lashain the knock of, right, there is no difference between if there's a hole or there's no hole. However, as you can tint them a base, the only difference is regarding the susceptibility of the food item, the seeds, that are inside, that are planted inside the pot itself. Then there's going to be a difference if there's a hole or not a hole. Which is, if it's a atzitz nakev, if it's a pot that has a hole, then it's not going to be susceptible to be vulnerable to tumah, because that's, since there's a hole, it's like considered attached to the ground. So when something's mechum lekarka, it cannot become, or else everything you ever had would always be hoshul kabel tumah, because it always gets wet when it rains. So it's not. When it's attached, it's not hoshul kabel tumah. When there's no hole, then it's going to be able to be hoshul kabel tumah, because that's considered attached. Something that's attached can become susceptible to tumah. Now, Rashi says that obviously this teaching was Reb Shimon, according to the Rabbanan. So then there's other differences because of liability of Nakuv, according to Rabbanan, would be violating Shabbos, but you'd be exempt by Ein Nakuv. So therefore, the Gemara's essential question is, how could you tell me, according to Reb Shimon, that there's no difference between Nakuv and Ein Nakuv? Are you seeing this Brice that there is a difference regarding the laws of Hechsher's drawing? Now, Taisis, we're not going to go through it, but Taisis asked the obvious question. What's the Gemara's question? If the question is that the Braisa says, just like the Mishnah, the Braisa says the same words, that for all purposes, Nakav is like Ein Nakav. It just says that one exception is Hechsher's Ram. And if the question is going to be, okay, so then why is Hechsher's Ram different than all the other laws? But then even without the Mishnah, you could ask in the Braisa itself. The Braisa itself says that it's the same for everything besides Hechsher's Ram. So Taisa discusses that, but that's like the obvious question. Why ask it from a Braisa on the Mishnah? It's in the Braisa itself. Says the same words, as the same idea as the Mishnah, and it's just saying Hechsher's Ram is different. But be that as it may, that's the Gemara's question. Hechsher's Ram sounds like that you are going to be Mechalik. Why? I thought it's the same thing, Nakav to Ein Nakav. So that says the Gemara, Amalei, and he says, Chol Mili, it's like we said before. For all halachic purposes, for the laws of Shabbos, like we're discussing in our Mishnah, or let's say to do Meshicha, to acquire something with Meshicha without money, or let's say for a principle, which it could only be written on a piece of land, Reb Shimon holds that atzus nakav is not going to be like ground. It's ketalish mashvile. He considers it like we said in the Mishnah to ein nakav. He doesn't differentiate if there's a hole or not a hole. Even if there's a hole, it's considered detached, and therefore if you pick it up in the ground, not going to be chayav on Shabbos. Shani linen tumah, the one area that he differentiates, like you're seeing here in this brisa, regarding the laws of tumah that we consider attached to the ground, it's not going to be susceptible to be mekabel tumah, is over there with the hole he considers it attached to the ground. Why over there? I thought you don't care about the hole. I thought the hole doesn't make it, it's not planted in the ground. Yes, because that Torah ribs it tahara itzelzron. It's exes a custom. The Torah included different elements of tahara. It made more levels of purification that it's not going to be susceptible to tumah by the seeds. Where? Shanama, like it says in the Pasuk in the Yikur, which the source of this halacha of being susceptible to tumah, says in the Pasuk, I'll call zera zirua zera. Many is the word zera over there, right? Many on every growing seed that will be seeded. Which means to say, and this is the idea of the pasuk, is that the way a person takes out a seed to be planted, that's a food item. It's separate, it's detached. That type of a seed, when it comes in contact with liquid, is gonna be hokshul kabel tumah. So on that extra zera zeruah, sheh zera, that's why it says all these words zrias, like Rashi says, is coming to exclude if it's even detached on any level whatsoever. So though you're right, he generally holds that even if there's a hole, it's not really attached to the ground. But on some level, he agrees when you have a hole in the bottom, it gets nourishment from the ground. So in some level, it's considered attached. So that's what the pasuk is coming to say. We're saying the word zera so many times, only how it's normally planted. You don't usually plant something that's already attached. Here it's already attached, so in some way, so that's why it's going to be hoshul kabel tumah. Contrary, there's no hole at all, so it's totally detached. There is not going to be hoshul kabel tumah. So therefore, it's not a contradiction. It's a special ribui that we have regarding the laws of Tahara, where with here, that an atzis nakiv is not going to be susceptible to tumah simply because, like we said, on Torah ribsa, there has many different ribuyim for the laws of Zerayim, and that's why it's exceptional over here. But in general, it's not going to have that halacha. So now the Gemara continues on this opinion of Reb Shimon. So the Gemara has the following question. So, Ba'yimineh ha'hu sabim Reb Zeir. A certain elder asked Reb Zeir, he says, Shoyrish kenegeneke. Let's say there's a root that's directly beneath the hole. Ma'liyam Reb Shimon, what would Shimon say over here? In other words, although we said that he holds, even when there's a hole in the pot, he still considers attaching, he's not going to be chayef for lifting it up on Shabbos. But would he agree that here it's like it's attached because this root is directly opposite the hole, and therefore if you take it away on Shabbos, you'd be chayef for toilish. So Ishtik Sahih was silent. He didn't answer. Zayr didn't answer his question.
Zimnachada, a different time, Ashkechei, the Yasubakama, he encountered Reb Zera, this elder, who is sitting in his talk and he's saying the following in the shir, he was saying like this. He says, a mighty Rishim, Rishim agrees, although he says with a hole in the pot, it's still considered detached. She'im nikiv, if the flower pot, if the pot has a hole, the chdei tarasai, the amount that would purify it, meaning if the pot became tameh, when it would get this type of a hole, it would break. It would become tahar, which as we're going to shortly explain later on, the sugya is the size of an olive. As we learned in Mishnah Seftis Kalim, that an earthenware vessel that's made for food items, the measurement of how big a hole would invalidate the size of an olive. Rabbi Shimon agrees in such a case that, oh, now it's already considered attached to the ground, any of the seeds that are inside of it, because now it's not a kli anymore to be a hefsek, to be in the way. It's like it's a broken, it's not a kli anymore. So now we consider it on the ground. So it's considered attached to the ground. He agrees in that case that it would be Hoch Shlokabot Tumah. So though he says, gentlemen, there's a hole, it's not being Hoch Shlokabot Tumah. It's such a big hole, it's already considered like it's on the ground. And it's considered like it's attached. So Natamali, the elderly person said to him, wait a second, Hashto, if now, Shorish Kenege Nekev, regarding when there was a root opposite the hole, Boim enough, I asked you if Reb Shimon would agree over there. Veloim Ali Vlamid, you didn't tell me anything, which that's directly opposite the root, that would make sense, and the hole's right there, that would be like really nourishing from the ground. So Nikev Bechdei Tarasa, I said, regarding when there's just a hole, that's just the amount that would purify the size of an olive. Mibaya, is that a question that you have to be in doubt regarding if it's not opposite the hole of the where the root is? And yet you're saying it as a simple halacha that everyone would agree, even Reb Shimon, that it's considered attached. So why didn't you answer my question when I asked you when it's directly opposite the hole? So Abaya says, which as the Mefarshim explained, he's really addressing this question and he's saying why it's not difficult. He says, if you're going to say Reb Zera's teaching, that what type of a hole did he say Reb Shimon agrees, that if there's going to be this such a big hole, it's going to be considered attached to the ground, this is how he said it. Reb Shimon agrees, depends where the hole is, that if it was so low, the hole in the pot, that it can't hold the revius anymore from where the hole is, because the hole, obviously all the liquid's going to be spilling out. So less than that, it cannot be considered kli. That's where it's not a kli according to Reb Shimon, and therefore that's not necessarily because it's opposite with the sherishes. That could be possibly on a higher point. If it's so low that it cannot hold the revius of liquid, so then that's where Reb Zeir was saying this halacha for Reb Shimon. And again, because of that that parameter of that halacha, even Reb Shimon would agree that the contents of the pot are considered attached to the ground, and that would be an exception to the rule. Now, we conclude with a very interesting halacha regarding, in the laws of Tuma, levels of holes for the vessels. Amar Rav says, Chamish Midas Bekli Cheres. He says, there's five different measurements for the invalidation of a earthenware vessel, which means to say, what considers it as a non-kli? So, Nikim Kamaitzi Mashka, the first category is, if it has a hole the size of that a liquid would drip out, so it has a very small hole, that liquid would spill out of it. So in such a case, tar milatami gistra, it's purified from contaminating as a gistra. In other words, if let's say you had a full, complete vessel, that would not be matar. If it had just a small hole that the liquid could come out, it would still be a kli. But if let's say it was a broken piece of a vessel, which you could still utilize a broken piece of a vessel, because it still has a kabbalah so the tumah when it breaks, as we learn in Mishnah Sefer Kim that says, Hein v'karkar saying v'difnei saying, if it could sit without needing being supported, the Gemara brings this in Chumdav Nandalam Abayis, that piece, broken piece, could be used because you could put it underneath a different vessel that has a small hole. So that's what we're telling you, the first case is telling you, but if, let's say, this broken piece developed a hole the size that liquid's going to come out of it, then it's not going to be tummy even because it's a gistra. The word gistra means a broken piece of a vessel. More later on, I'm going to explain the reasoning is that you don't say that a broken piece is considered significant to store it away if it has a hole. Because you're not going to say bring another gistera and put it beneath this gistera, which is dripping, and bring another one to drip. But if it was a full vessel and has a small little hole, then we're not going to throw it away. You say, we can still use it. We'll bring a gistera, we'll put it beneath. Even though it's dripping out a little bit, it's such a good bowl. We'll put a little thing, a shachkel underneath, and we'll go ahead and we'll catch whatever's dripping down. So that's what it's saying. Saying if it has the smallest of the five holes, which just liquid drips out of it, so then it's tar milatami gistra. As a gistra, if it's a broken shard, you're not going to use this gister. Again, remember, this gister is catching what's dripping out of a bowl. So now, if this gister has a hole the size that drips out, you're not going to say, oh, let's get another gister for that gister. That you're not going to do. So that's going to validate the gister. But, it's still a vessel. In other words, if let's say it was an intact vessel, and now it just got a small pin drop hole, where now liquids could drip out of it, it still has all the stringent halachas of being considered a vessel in all areas, even, and that's what we're saying over here, to sanctify the paradimo waters, which you have to have by the ash, you have to have mayim chayim, you have to have a vessel. Like the pasuk says, mamid b'yotes mayim chayim el keli. Now, for sure, it's going to have tumma of a kli. We're saying even the more stringent halacha of the paradimo waters, this can be considered kli. A small little hole doesn't invalidate it. It's the first category is only invalidating that of the gister. Case number two is a little bit bigger. We're getting bigger as we go along. Nikiv kukainis mashka. It has a hole the size of liquids could come into it. So if you put this bowl in water, water is going to come in, which has to be a slightly bigger hole. So here, already tar melekadosh by mechadis. But Rashi says the word tar doesn't mean precisely tar. It's like we had in the opening daf of Shas, tihir yoyma. Tihir yoyma means to say like the day has passed, means to say like it's already been nullified. Means to say it's nullified from the halacha of being a kli, regarding the laws of mechadis, because that was said the pasuk, it has to be a kli. It's already the size that liquids could come in, it's not going to be a valid vessel anymore, but it's still a vessel in regard to make the seeds susceptible to tumma that are planted inside, because it is still considered as a vessel that is detached from the ground, which, as Rashi explains, that's even like the Rabbanan of Reb Shimon, because such a hole is not fit to get nourishment from the ground. A tiny, tiny little hole. It's, although it's a little bigger than the Maitzi Mashka, but it's still only Kekoinis Mashka. It's a tiny hole, liquid could come into it. So therefore, it's still going to be machshav b'zrayim. It's not going to attach to the ground. But again, it's just possible for being used for the mechatas. Case number three, nikiv kasherish cotton. Let's say it's a hole the size of a small root, which gets more than liquid coming into the vessel. So tar melahachshav b'zrayim. So here we're going contra Rabbanan. It's not going to be able to make the seeds inside susceptible to tum, because this is what's called the atzitz nakat. It's that which has a hole inside the pot, and it's like attached to the ground. When something is attached, not susceptible to tum. But v'dayin kli v'kalbizesim, it's still going to be considered as a vessel that it could hold olives, which the hole is not as big as that of an olive, which that's the basic shear of tumma of a kli. All earthenware vessels that's made for food items, as long as it didn't designate it to be, let's say, for a larger fruit like pomegranate, it's still going to make kabel tumma, or it's still going to retain the tumma if the holes are only the size of a sherish cut, because it's still smaller than that of an olive, and if it's considered to be a kli regarding the laws of tumma. Case number four, nikiv kamaitzi zesa. But let's say the hole is the size of that olives would fall out of it, it's a very big hole. So then tar melakal by zesa. Then it's going to be tar from receiving olives. In other words, it's not going to be makabel de tumma anymore, because as a generic earthenware vessel, because like we said, their measurements are based on if it doesn't have the size of an olive. So if let's say it had tumma, it already would be considered purified, lost the tumma by being broken. But v'tan klihu l'kabel by remind, but it's still considered a vessel to receive pomegranates. In other words, if it was designated subsequently to be for pomegranates, now it's going to stop being makabel tumma, because it was now designated for larger fruits, which it is still good for. Or let's say it had originally been designated for pomegranates, it would not be purified by getting a hole the size of an olive, because it's still usable for what we use it for, which is pomegranates, which are much bigger than olives. Now, case number five is if let's say nikiv kamaitzi remaining. Let's say the hole already got very big. It's so big the size of pomegranates, tar meklum, then it's totally going to be tar from any halachic status of a vessel, unless if you put it away to be used as a gistra, Rashi explains. If you use it for a gistra, then it's going to have the tumma of a gistra, which we said then it could still be makabel tumma. If you're using it to receive things underneath another vessel that itself has a small hole, then it could be makabel tumma. But those are the five levels. Now, what the Gemara concludes, it says, but v'mhuk of tumma possible, but if let's say it's surrounded with a tightly fastened seal, and it's in the room where there's a dead person, so then the tumma is not going to come in through the hole, and it's going to save whatever's inside of it, because it has the tightly fastened seal, which is a unique halacha regarding that of a kli cheres. Until the majority of it has broken off. Because the pasuk says, kol kli pesuach, any open vessel, which the tumma comes in through the opening, and not through holes. So although it has a hole, but still it's not going to be kabel tumma. If it has a tightly fastened seal, it's going to be tar, even though it has a hole, because the tumma does not come in through holes, it comes only through a pesach. If the majority of it is broken already, then it's not going to be saving anymore. But up until the majority, the tzamid puzzle will save even though it has a hole. However, Amr Abasi says, Shemati says, I heard Kli Cheres, the earthenware vessel, Shiur Kamaitzirimen. Says, I heard it's the size of that it's that pomegranates are going to fall out, meaning, not like we said before, which is the size of a, we said it's the size of an olive. We said a Nikiv Kamaitzirimen is the generic status for an earthenware vessel. He says, I heard it's the way of pomegranates falling out of it. And Adamali Rabbi says, wait a second. Shemele Shemata, maybe you only heard a little muk of Tzamid Pasel when it's surrounded with a tightly fastened seal. That's where we're going to say that if it has a hole the size of a pomegranate, then it's not going to save. But not in a regular earthenware vessel. Or a regular earthenware vessel would be the size of an owl. But the Gemara asks, wait a second, but Rabbi, what Amar Rabbi just said, as recorded before, muk of Tzamid Pasel, if it's tightly fastened seal on the opening of the vessel, it's actually Yifchus Shubah until the majority of it is broken off. So how can you say it's until the size of a pomegranate? So that said, the Gemara like Kashin, this is where we end. As you continue to talk about Tzadik Vav and Aleph, ha bergavdavi, ha. When did we say it's until the majority of the vessel breaks? Is bergavdavi is by a large vessel. A large vessel, it's only considered deficient if the majority of it broke. But vaha, when did we say that it's the size of the pomegranate that he was explaining for his halacha, telling him maybe you heard this that it's invalidated when pomegranates could fall out, that bezutri, that's by a small vessel. A small vessel is already considered, if it already has such a big hole, the size of a pomegranate, that's going to validate it. So again, it depends what type of vessel it is, what the share of being mevatel, that the summit puzzle is not going to work for the vessel. Some of this we spoke about today's daf and Shabbos daf tzadik hey, was the halacha, the mishnah, the remachlekes, if the chiv is the reiso, or is it a shvus, is it the bin. Some interesting cases was Gedelis, if she braids her hair, Kefelis, if she paints her eye, and Pekes has two interpretations of Rashi. These are all ways that women take care of themselves. Self-care is either that she combs her hair, or it's that she puts on dough on her face, which when they remove it, it makes a reddish type of a complexion. Now, we want to know what malachas derises are these things. So the first interpretation, which we put in the yellow, which because that's the one that doesn't stand, is a regis. The braiding here is because she's weaving. That's what she's doing when she... Nothing was. It's not the way of doing it. Or Kefela's painting is Kesebes. It's she's writing. Because she traces around her eyes. That's like what one does when they write. And Pekeses is spinning. Which, even it's because of the strands of the dough, they would make like in thread-like strands. Or when she's in disentangling her hair, when she's combing, it's making them into separate strands, like threads of hair. Making a thread, which is what spinning is. But the Gemara rejects because ein derech. It's not the way. And for the malacha, it has to be the way. So rather, the Gemara interprets that braiding is because of baina. It's because of building. Kecheles, painting the eyes because she's dying. And pekeses, hiroso, is because of building. Now, why is braiding the hair considered building? So the Gemara brought in a Gadic teaching that we find that the braiders are called builders. Like it says, ve'yivin Hashem alakim ha-satzela, Hashem built Chava, she was already built. He braided her here. Braiding here is like building the person. And then that's why the Gemara actually qualifies that this teaching is only for her friend, because to do it in a good way, to braid one's hair, is only as a professional and normal in the way when you're doing it for someone else. Doing it yourself, you can't do as good as a job, and therefore that would not be the malacha deraisa of building. This should be said, you now put srak, which is rouge, on the woman, because it's tzivas, it's dyeing the skin. We're going to similar type of machlekes in the braisa, regarding many different cases, if it's a malacha d'iraisa or d'rabban. We had regarding milking and regarding the first process of making cheese, which is the selecting part, and Megavon, which is actually putting the pieces of cheese together. So the Gemara ultimately explained that Chaylev, after the Moira that didn't answer every time he said the same thing back, says milking is because of mefarik, because you're actually unloading, you're taking the milk from the udders. When you're milking, you're doing what dash essentially is threshing, is taking the grain from the stalk, here moving the milk from the udder. That's mafarik, that's a pelod of dash. When you're doing mechabits, you're doing bar, because what happens is that you let it sift through the whey from the udder, from the clumps of the cheese, and therefore that's selecting. And megabin, which is putting the pieces of cheese together, making the cheese, is playing this building. So to mechabits, sweeping, and megabits, which is settling the dust, are playing this building. Or it's a shvus, it's rabbinic concern because of building. That's what the Gemara says, according to the Rabbanan, if it's rabbinic. So a smart woman, what she does is that she could go ahead and wash her hands in this corner and do it in the other corner. And we said in today's times, anyways, it's not a problem because Holy Grip Shimon that Mutal Ketchila, because it's Ein Miskaven, it's not your intention. And therefore, even if that would happen, that would be permitted. You're allowed to settle the dust because you're not trying to fill up the holes to make it Bainam. And then we had the last case, interestingly, if someone takes the honeycomb, so we said that what would be the problem over there? Because the Pasuk says, V'yit v'leis to b'yaris hadvash. Why is honey considered like a forest? To tell you, just like a forest, you now take what's obviously detached from the ground. It's toilish. So to over here, we're saying that this would be considered toilish by taking the honey from where it starts, where it's made, even though it's not really attached to the ground. That would be also as toilish. Then we can come in the next Mishnah about toilish ma'atzis. Someone detaches the flower, the pot from the ground. So the question is, so then it depends. If it doesn't have a hole, so everyone's going to agree that you're going to be potter because there's no hole, so it's not attached to the ground. If there's a hole, so then we had a machlekes. The Tanakhama says, okay, so then you're going to be chayv because there's a hole, it's attached to the ground. Shimon says, no, you're going to be potter. Now, the reason is because he considers hole is like if it's no hole. It's the same thing, it's considered detached, it's not planted in the ground. But we said, I by Hechshah Zroim, regardless of separate, he does consider like attached to the ground, that is, it's not going to be Huchshu L'Kabel Tumah. Obviously, because it's considered attached to the ground. If it's detached, of course, it can be susceptible to tumah. He said no, because it says zirias yisera, zera shizera. It says all these different terms of zizera to tell you what's the normal way that you plant. Normal way when you plant would be something that's totally detached, not attached. Here, on some level, it's attached. Therefore, the utz is not given. That way, is going to be exception to the rule that it's going to be considered attached to the ground, not hokshla kavat tumah. Then we continue and explain the contrary of Shimon, who generally holds, like we said, if there's a hole, it doesn't make a difference. It's not considered attached. But if, let's say, the hole is b'chteta rasa, which is the size of a zayas, then it's going to be considered attached to the ground. And some say, which that's what Abaye says, that's why it would answer the question, why Abzeri didn't answer according when he says it's keneged the shayrish, is that it's only if it's lamata mervias. Which means, say, on the vessel, if the hole is so low that obviously all the liquid, whatever's in there, would be spilling out over here, wouldn't be able to hold the revias. So then that's considered not a vessel at all, and therefore that's where Shimon agrees it would be considered attached to the ground. And we ended over with Rav is saying that there's five different types of measurements in the Kli Cheres regarding making a hole. First one was if it's Meitzi Mashka, just a tiny little hole that liquid could drip out. So then we said that as a Gistera, it's not going to be Makabel Tumah. Because a Gistera, if it's going to have a hole dripping out, the whole point is to catch from something else that's dripping out. So that's not going to be valid as a Gistera, but it's still a Kli even to be, and it's like even. Even to be Mekadosh Meichatz, which requires a Kli, it's still a Kli for all practical purposes. Let's say it's larger. Let's say the size of Kainis Mashka, that liquid could even seep in, not just drip out. So then he says, no. Then it's Batal, which means to say it's not going to be valid anymore of being a Kli for Meichatz, but it's still a Kli for Hechshah Zroim, because it what's inside of that vessel would be considered Teilish. It's not considered attached to the ground with such a small hole. Whatever seeds are inside, not going to be Kabel Tumah. Then we said the third category is if it has a hole the size of a small root, just a slightly bigger hole. So then we said that it's not going to be machshad Zroim, meaning it's going to be tahar, which means to say it's going to be considered as mechubar, just according to the Rabbanim of Rib Shimon. That's what's considered as the atzitz nakiv, as we discussed in the previous halacha. It has a hole, so we consider it as attached to the ground, but it's still a kli regarding the kabbalization, regarding the laws of tumah, because it doesn't have a hole the size of an olive. So it's still going to be Kabel Tumah. Let's say it has a hole the size that even olives would fall out of it. Oh, so then it's not going to be Kabel Tumah anymore because it's already invalidated. But it's still a Kli. If let's say you designate it to be for pomegranates, so then there is a Kli for that and it's going to be Kabel Tumah. Let's say it has a hole the size that even pomegranates fall out. Then it's Tumah Klum. Besides, Rashi says it could be as a Gistera. For that it could be, but for all practical purposes, it has no Tumah at all. Then we said, but let's say even if it has this hole the size of a pomegranate, if it's surrounded with a tightly fastened seal, which Rashi explains that Tumah can only come through the Pesach, not through the holes, then it's going to save even what's inside of it in the Oil HaMes. But the Gemara then says it depends. If it's a large vessel, so then it's still the majority of it breaks off. As long as the majority doesn't break off, so Tumah doesn't come in through the holes, it only comes through the opening. The opening is covered with a tightly fastened seal, it's going to protect. But if it's a small vessel, then it's going to be, as he interpreted for the other ones, halacha, it's going to be kamaitzi rimain, even just the size of a pomegranate, because it's very small, a hole the size of a pomegranate, it's already considered invalidating the vessel, and then it's going to be tahar meklum, it's not going to have any tumah whatsoever. Thank you to any time for hosting us.